You're scanning, all right. Scans in your face. It says scanning.
But I like your plastic.
Well, I guess we're going to get started this morning. My name is Joey Herman, and I work for a company called Dedicated Professional Resources. And we're located here in downtown Winston-Salem. We're an HR consulting firm. And this morning, I have the privilege of coming to talk to you guys about effective interviewing. First of all, a couple of housekeeping issues. Can everybody hear me? I'm a software guy. Can everybody hear me okay? Can you hear me in the back? And I will say, I've got a short video I want to show to you guys. And unfortunately, we don't have speakers. And so it does have Sam. And I played it earlier. It's playing through the laptop. So if you really want to hear the video of Sam, you might want to move forward. I'll give you that chance now if you want to move forward. But if not, you can kind of get the idea. But so obviously, you guys are here this morning to learn a little bit more about interviewing. And I don't know if I have the secret sauce, but I definitely got some tips. I was asked to present on this topic a few months ago, and the guy that asked me to come and speak, he said, hey, I want you to come in and tell us how to tell if somebody is good in the first 5 minutes of the interview. So that's all I've got really to devote to interviews. And, you know, is that something you can do? And I kind of felt like he was asking me to be a fortune teller. And unfortunately, I wish that was the case. I wish I had that answer where within the first 5 minutes you can tell if somebody's going to be a good hire or not. It's just not easy. Nothing usually is. You've got to devote some time. You've got to block out your schedule and really focus in on that aspect. But we are going to talk about some effective techniques to help you do that all the way. Is everybody here? Obviously, you're here because you want to learn how to be a better interviewer. Is that something you do in your job currently? Okay. How do you feel like you do a good job at it? Yeah. Okay, so it's something new for you?
Yeah. No, it's not new for me, but be a person
you need to be. You're one of that. Okay. Well, I don't know you guys, but I can just tell that I think you guys are pretty good. At least I know that you're better than my friend Tripp. I got a video here of guiding Tripp, who is a terrible interviewer, and so we I know you're better than this guy.
Doing for a game?
Hi.
Hi. That's not okay. So, who's that?
Alright,
let's see it. Awesome. Awesome.
Very well,
thank you. That's my name, resume. Okay. Get out! Just kidding. Just kidding. It's nice.
Obviously, Tripp needs some help. He should be in this class, but I know you guys deserve Tripp. I just know that. I hope so. So today, I'm going to help you guys climb what I call Kilimanjaro. I've got a survival guide put together. We'll talk about some pitfalls, techniques, and we'll finally talk about some ways that you guys can really dig down and get the person talking about themselves. First thing we're going to do is talk about some survival tips. So let's talk about what not to ask. You guys know these things, right? Your HR departments have probably come and talked to you about what you can and can't ask. So what are some things you can't ask about? You guys know these things, right?
Do you have kids?
You have kids, family. Okay, what else?
Sexual preference.
Sexual preference. What else?
Your age.
Age, right.
Religion.
Religion, yeah. What else? Political? I don't think that's protected, but that's a very good idea not to ask about that. Yeah, just leave that out. Yeah, especially once you guys do government assessment. Yeah, so you guys know these things. Age, nationality, gender, origin, religion, race, family, and health. I don't think anybody mentioned health. Don't ask anything about their health. So, this is an interactive part of the session. I've got some questions here. If you think you know it, just raise your hand or shout it out. So, is this a legal question to ask in an interview? I'm going to go through several. So, first one, are you a U.S. citizen? Is that a legal question to ask?
Yes, it is.
Raise them high. Okay. Anybody say no? This is not legal. And tell me if it's tricky. I'm trying to trick you. What's legal to ask is, are you eligible to work in the United States? Okay. It's a fine line there, but you don't have to actually be a U.S. citizen to work in the United States. Okay. So be careful about asking if they're a citizen, even on the application. The application should not say that. It should say, are you eligible to work? Okay. Next one. You guys will be shy. What is your native tongue? Is that a legal question to ask? What you can ask is, what languages do you speak fluently? That's perfectly fine to ask. But again, that key word is native. It's kind of going back to the nationality. Okay. What is your current address? Is that a legal question to ask? Who says no? Who says yes? Yes, okay. We can ask where they live. That's usually on the application. What you don't want to ask is, stay away from is, where did you grow up, or how long have you lived here, that sort of thing. But their current address, where they currently live, that's my last. All right. What religious holidays do you need off? Why not? Yeah, it's kind of inferring what religion you are. So, you guys are right, not legal. What you can ask is, are you available to work our regular schedule? You can present your schedule, you can present, you know, what the expectations are, and are they, you can ask, are you available to work that schedule? Okay. All right. What does your husband do for a living? Is that something you should ask? Not legal. What you can ask is, are you available to work that required schedules? You know, keep it on task. Stay away from the family questions. Did you graduate high school?
Yes.
Sure.
Was your high school?
Right.
Yeah, because you can ask if they actually went to college.
Yeah, it's okay. It's okay. What you want to stay away from is, when did you graduate? Now, it may be on the application, and they may write it down, they may be on the resumes, that's fine, but you just wanna stay away from asking when they graduate high school. Why do we wanna say that? What else, Mark, we can add, that's all we're here to. Okay, you'll be required to work overtime on short notice.
That's something.
That's a problem.
That's what he said, no, he said there's two.
If I said no? That's good, that's a really good question. What you wanna stay away from is questions like, can I get a babysitter, or can you get a babysitter on short notice for overtime? So again, what is that like? Ask you about family. It doesn't matter if they get a babysitter or not, again, you just wanna ask them, can you work short notice, overtime if asked? Keep it job related. How many sick days did you take last year? This one's not legal, however, you can ask how many days of work did you miss last year? What's the difference? Right, we're not asking about sick time, we're just asking about total days off. You can't ask that. Has anybody asked that question, how many days off? Are you doing that? Do you have any disabilities? Let's stay away from that. So what should you ask for parts of disabilities? Are you able to perform the specific duties of this position with or without reasonable accommodations? And you guys hopefully should have a list of those duties or a job description in the interview in case they have any questions about that. Which restroom do you feel comfortable with? The one that's free? Yeah, let's get away from this one. Again, I'll just go back to, are you in specific duties on the position with or without reasonable accommodations? All right, you guys can get on that. So now let's talk about what are some of the keys to a good interview. I've got four up here for you. First one is I like to make them feel comfortable that this is already a stressful situation that they're coming into an unknown environment. They're coming in to meet somebody that they've never met. This person has a lot of influence and control over their life possibly in the near future. A lot of people get very uncomfortable, so I try to put them at ease right from the start. Do you guys interview by yourselves, or does anybody do like panel interviews?
Yeah.
I like panel interviews. I think that's a great idea. But again, that can kind of contribute to being a more intimidating environment or something. So, how many people do you guys use in a panel interview?
Five to six
people. So, can you imagine walking in and having five or six people sitting across from you now? I mean, that's pretty intimidating.
What do you think would be a good, I once actually went to an interview at UNCW and there are 14 people all like in a classroom and I'm under a hot lights like sweating. Like what do you think is a good number where it's
that's a good question. I like three, I think that's a good number that where you're getting some different perspectives and ideas and so honest one. You're getting good feedback after the interview once you all talk, but you know, it's not so many where you're really making that person feel like that. But it just depends on your situation and how many people are part of that decision-making process. But I do like the idea of having one number. I like the idea of it's good time utilization. You know, instead of having that person come back and interview three different times, let's just knock it out and get all these people together and have multiple questions prepared. I like to have questions prepared ahead of time and everybody kind of know what they're going to ask. And then each and every interview, you kind of get into a rhythm of routine and everybody's kind of used to ask the same questions. It's good practice. Good question. Any other questions?
Yeah, just me. Better normally, but they always count it.
I think that's a great idea. more diversity on the board, different perspectives that you have weighed in on that person. So I think it's good to have a manager, you know, leader possibly, if appropriate. You know, maybe somebody from the next department, if appropriate. Yeah, different sex. I think it's good. You know, we're all different. We all bring different things to the table. We all have different senses about people. And sometimes, you know, one of them pick up on something that two guys on the panel didn't pick up on. So, I think it's good to get more diversity, make it better. Any other questions? All right, so make people comfortable. The next thing I'd like to do is explore their work experience. We'll get into this a little bit. Then I really like to get into what I call barbecue behavior-based questions. You guys ever heard this term, behavior-based questions? We're going to get into what that is. And finally, make sure you give them time to ask their questions. If they don't have any questions, I think that says something as well. You know, if they didn't make questions at the table. But make sure you give them some time to ask them. You're interviewing them. But ideally, you know, you're giving them the opportunity to interview you and your town, your government, your company. And you know, the idea is to make a good match here. And so you're looking for that match, but they're also looking for a good match as well. And you want to make sure you have the right information to present so they can make a good decision. So, all right, so start with your interview off on a good footing. So like I mentioned, I like to make people comfortable. I like to offer them some water when they come in. Always keep the door open or cracked. You know, you want to have some privacy, you know, for the interview, but you never want to make them feel like they're closed off or can't get out, so people get claustrophobic, especially, again, they're in a stressful situation. If it's a one-on-one interview, and if it's a male-female interview one-on-one, please leave that door open. Don't close that door. That's just a bad practice in any situation. You always want to have that door. And then I like to ask a few warm-up questions, and a lot of times I'll do this, you know, going to the conference room or going to my office. You know, how's the weather? How did you hear about the position? Do you know much about the company, or do you know much about, you know, our town or our government? How it works, you know, how big we are. Just give them some easy questions to kind of warm up the motor a little bit. Give them a little bit more comfortable with who you are. Hopefully that'll make it more at ease. Any questions about this? Make them feel comfortable. Does anybody do this? Anybody have a good practice that they like to do? Make them feel comfortable.
I'm sexy.
Yeah.
Sitting on with them, and she's sitting on with them about herself. We do interview for you for as long as we can. We'll just sit around the table with the questions.
I love that. Yeah.
Yeah.
So a lot of times I've participated in panel interviews, and like all of my managers are lining up on one side of the table and the interview. And obviously with the interview person, I sit right beside. Yeah, to make it more focused. You don't want to have that absurd feel to it that thus gets there. Yeah, I think that's a terrible situation to put in, and, you know, you've got 14 people in a spotlight, that's very counterproductive. So, yeah, anything you can do to make them feel at home, but I do that as well. I'll sit aside and make them feel a part of it, make them feel more like a conference. Any questions? Anything else? All right, so I like to talk about work experience next. Ask them to tell you about their work experience, your job history. I like to start with their last job. You kind of work on the way backwards. I like to follow along with the application, the resume. You know, I'll bring several copies of the resume to the interview. If you guys are doing panel interviews, make sure everybody in the interview's got a copy of their resume. And I just ask them, hey, you know, take me through your work history. Start with your latest job. Tell me about what a typical day was like. Tell me about your experiences there, tell me about what your duties and responsibilities were there, and then just work backwards. The third bulletin point here is very, very important. I want you guys to remember this part. A lot of people skip over this. Always, always ask about each transition between their jobs, why they change jobs. A lot of people like to gloss over this, and if they do that, they can go back and explain, you know, what happened there. There's a lot of hidden information in gyms to why people change jobs. It's just part of life. I mean, we don't expect that not to happen, but we do want to understand why they transition changed. And you can get a lot of good nuggets of information just as we talk about what happened there. It could be, you know, a better opportunity. It could be they're fired, it could be they quit, they had, you know, health issues. And again, you don't want to go down that rabbit path if they bring up health issues, you better get something they're bringing forward to let you know about. It could be to take care of a family member that has health issues. I've seen all kinds of reasons, so it's very important to learn about why those changes were made. It's also very important to learn about gaps. You know, so if you see a gap, from 2008, they worked somewhere in 2013, and then they didn't have another job until 2015. Well, what happened in those 2 years? Where were you at? What were you doing? If that's not on the resume, make sure you ask about it. And then make them describe what their responsibilities were and what a typical day was like in each position. So what are you guys hoping to get from this? Going through their experiences, just listen and talk about it. Yeah, I mean, you're looking for their skill sets, but also you're looking for how they view their past jobs. And a lot of their attitudes could possibly come out and how they describe past positions, past employers. A lot of good things there. So the idea is for you to get them talking. The whole idea of the whole interview is to get them talking about themselves. You know, nothing's more frustrating than having an interview where you got a plan across the table. They're just not really sharing. They're like, yep, yes, but the idea is to get them talking about themselves. And the more they talk, the more you learn, and the better information that you'll have to make good hires. All right, now we're at the mark view, which is what I call this part is behavior-based questions. So past performance is the best indicator of future performance. Behavior-based questions are simple questions about their past experience, how they performed in those experiences. So who's familiar with behavior-based questions? Okay, so what's a good behavior-based question? I've got some examples, but does anybody have one that they like to ask?
Describe how you handle the conflict.
Okay, very good. That's a very good question. So that's a good behavior-based question. So what you're asking in that question is, tell me about time or tell me about a specific event that actually occurred in your past. Tell me about it, tell me what happened, and tell me how you resolved it. Okay? You're not asking a hypothetical question in which they would have a chance to make tell you what you want to hear. You're asking them to describe something that actually occurred. That's the difference between hypothetical and behavior-based question. So make it very important. And, you know, I'll show you something different there. So here's some examples. So that was very similar to your question, the one I have here. Tell me about a time when you didn't get along with a coworker, and how did you handle that situation? So you're making some assumptions here. You're making an assumption what? That there was a time in their past when they didn't get along with a coworker. Is that a good assumption to make?
Yeah.
It's probably happened. It's probably happened to all of us at some point. And what it does is it really forces them to kind of dig back to the past, think about a time when there was a conflict, makes them a little vulnerable, but what it does hopefully is paint a picture as to how they'll handle that situation. And how they handle it in the past is a very, very good indicator of how they'll handle it in your organization. Okay. So here's another question. Describe a day at work when you were overwhelmed with orders to fill. What was your approach to the situation? Has that ever happened? And it may, you know, depending on what you're hiring for, you guys really should sit down and develop some good behavior-based questions that are applicable to position we're hiring for. If this position you're hiring for does not take orders, you know, this may not be a good question. Think about scenarios that this person will be in, and then, you know, you can get more behavior-based questions.
One of the things that we've had to go for with in the past is hiring for an entry-level position that the person, this would be their first job. I don't know if you have that on hiring for some people or for some positions that this is their first job right out of high school. Maybe after getting a GED.
Right.
So they don't necessarily have had a work experience.
Right. That's a very good point. Does anybody else run into that issue?
Well, no, then we ask, as we say, because about training out the need they have work or school.
Yep.
Because they aren't in high school. So there's this, they run into people still in school that they can have difficult ways that they got to work with. So
that's exactly right. That's a great point. Thank you for sharing that. Yeah, I mean, even though they haven't had a job, they've had other life experiences, whether it be school, organizations, clubs that they've worked in, volunteer work that they've done, church activities. They probably brought them along some other activities that they can kind of pull and draw from. And they will pull and draw from those experiences to apply to this one job. But think about that. I think you do have to kind of tailor the questions a little bit if it has an entry level position by the house. Yes, ma'am.
One of the ones we like to do, especially in IT, because you're servicing people, one of the questions we always ask is, tell us the time when you went above and beyond. And it's amazing how sometimes above and beyond is what you're supposed to do. So it gives you a good indication of, this person doesn't understand what above and beyond means. Like, oh, I called them that. Well, yeah, that's what you're supposed to do. So, and then some like come up with crazy scenarios that they're actually one of my workers already. And I'm like, no, that wasn't above and beyond. So it's interesting to see what they.
I spoke to somebody today in the hallway.
Right. Yeah. I got coffee for my coworkers or something.
I think that's a great, great question. You know, again, you're just trying to get them to talk about what their views are on things and what is above and beyond. And a lot of good behavior-based questions start with that phrase, can you tell me about a time? Can you tell me about an event in your past where this happened? That's a good one. Actually, I have a version of that. Yeah. Yep. Looking ahead. So tell me about a time when you went above and beyond what was expected of you. That's a great question. Another one is tell me about a time when you helped a coworker finish a project or an order. So again, you know, just really looking at, you know, are they somebody that's willing to help you? Some people are more inclined to help others, and is that something that you're looking to have in that position? It has a very helpful nature, and that might be a good question. So I've got a couple of good examples here, and then I've got a couple of really bad examples of questions that we should stay away from. So don't ask, would you work overtime to finish an order if asked? So why should we not ask that question?
They're going
to
say yes.
Yeah, they're going to say, of course I will work. It's a yes-no question. You want to stay away from the yes-no questions because it's so easy for somebody to say yes. I'll work there. No problem. What should you ask instead of? If you want to learn about someone's willingness to work there. What's a good thing?
What would you do if your project was unstable?
I'm sorry?
What would you do if your project was unstable?
Well, of course, yeah. I'd rather do whatever you have. What's another way to ask that? Yep. Tell me about time. Tell me about a situation in your last job where you guys were required to work overtime. How much overtime did you work? What was the outcome? Did you get it completed on time? Tell me about that whole thing and how it worked out and how you feel about it. So now, again, you're asking them to not make up something, not give you an answer they think you want to hear, and you're asking them to dig in their past, pull
actually happened, tell you about it, tell you how they interacted in that situation.
All right, one more. Don't ask, would you help the person next to you catch up if they fell behind?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, absolutely. I would. I'm a very helpful person.
So stay with me, ask no questions.
All right.
Always ask any questions related to your field. So I went and looked up some possible IT questions here, so you've got to look and write them down. Can you tell me about a time, or tell me about a recent project or process that you made better, faster, smarter, and more efficient? You guys like that question?
Wow.
So again, it's just tell me about specific things that you have done in your past that tell us more about you. Number two, tell me about technology related blogs, podcasts, tweets, websites that you follow. Did you share any information about yourself online? Or do you share any information yourself online? Is this a big deal for you guys? I had a client in Greensboro a few months ago. They had an employee that really got into a bad situation with. He was going to some of these information to share websites and sharing ideas, which is something they encouraged, but he crossed the line as far as sharing proprietary information. And it crossed the point where they were not comfortable with what he was sharing. Is this something you guys typically do? This was a new practice for me to hear about.
We are starting to talk a little bit more about certain social media sites where our organization has a presence, and are you active on that site? These are some kind of, especially with the real community people who they work for, how we share on social media.
Right. So that's a whole other can of worms, social media, whether or not you have your organization have a policy about that. This was more directed towards like a work-related share site, not Facebook, but it's more for programmers to go kind of share ideas and that sort of thing. I'd get to make it site, but more field-related. But very good point about social media. I would encourage you to talk to your HR or your employees about how they want to handle asking questions about that. Then finally, can you tell me about a time when you were assigned a project involving a new technology and how did you get started? So these are just some examples, but what I really wanted you guys to start thinking about is, what are some good behavior-based questions that I can ask for not only your field, but the specific position that you're hiring for? So, what I put up here is kind of very generic, general conflict. How do you feel about this? How did you handle this situation? But you really want to, the more specific you can make the question related to the field, the better it is for the answer that you're going to get.
So actually, I'm going to be doing interviews next week.
Yep.
And we have a question. I want to know what you think of this. Tell me about a time you had a project that failed. Why and how did it fail? What did you do?
Great question.
That's good. Yes, yeah, similar to that, we wanted to have a company with a four project stage, a list of stage, and put two learned from the stage that we go with the one test. So yeah. Another great question. Or they tell us something they actually get every now and then somebody that they can look something really quick, but some people they never make a mistake.
That's the way I feel. I love those questions that you guys are talking about. And it kind of goes back to the old, tell me what are your best qualities, what are your worst qualities. It's a derivative of that, but I like good questions better because they're behavior based. Okay, definitely answer those questions. I think it tells a lot about a person how they answer it, more so than what they answer. But yeah, you're exactly right. I've had people in interviews say, no, I don't know. I got a problem with that. That's a big red flag for me personally. If someone's not willing to talk about a mistake, because we all know that's a problem. Yes, ma'am.
Last stuff on there, and she was exhausted, I was just, you know, just watching her. And one of the questions that she was asked, had been switched, I said, this is something like that. And she was like, I hate to shoot my own horn, but I'm just great. And I mean, she did like 4 or 5 times on her. You know, you probably are, but nobody will be in the same. But she has some other things as far as like gaps in time and things like that, just ended up a relationship with divorce or something like that. She offered that information. And we were like, you know, she probably needs a little time just to deal with that before, you know, just rushing right into another school, new kids, new environment, and all that. Still not gonna give herself anything negative in any way.
It's a sales job. I mean, they're there. I mean, some people view it as they're presenting themselves in a sales situation. And if you think about it this way, what you see in an interview is the absolute best the person's gonna be. It's just gonna go downhill from there. they are putting on their Sunday best and presenting and telling you everything that they think you want to hear. It's not getting any better than what you're seeing. So keep that in mind. Yes, sir.
Just curious, Steve, kind of what you just said here. I mean, you when we pull the resume, so you determine that they have, well, at least resume-wise, the basic skills needed for the job. I mean, where does fit come in here? Because you said you talk to a person, and in an interview, you try to determine also how well they're going to fit with the team that they got to work with. Where does that?
Yeah, I think that's a great point. So usually if they're there in an interview, you know, they have enough on their resume to get your attention.
Right.
And so you've got a pretty good idea about the qualification. You feel like, you know, they at least have the skill set and the knowledge to do the job. But that's really the whole point, in my opinion, of an interview is to determine that. You know, everybody's got their own culture or even microcultures in, you know, certain departments or even, you know, certain offices may have a culture that you're looking for. I think it's important to develop your questions to help you determine if that person will be a good fit.
See, they almost like come in feeling just ruin the whole team that does work for years. Because the job also gives somebody like this person, just right. Everybody else that I hate for.
So I was going to go back to what you were saying there. You know, I've seen interviewers, managers, you know, have that person interview, they just get overwhelmed, or not overwhelmed, but they really get taken in by that personality. Like, oh, they're great, and they start turning a blind eye to some of the things. And we talked before at the meeting, you know, you mentioned that your boss will bring you in because you have a good sense about people, and it sounds like you've got the ability to kind of look at the whole picture of a person.
Well, my boss in this situation wanted to go, and she had a boyfriend that was the boss didn't sit in on the interview. It was the assistant principal, a board member, and me. And when we went back to the office, the assistant principal wasn't in the room. She asked us, the boss asked us, what do y'all think? And we both of us were saying the exact same things. And she was like, wow. And I just saw the energy and all that.
And it's very easy to get taken away with that. And that's why I love the panel interviews, because it was just your boss. She probably would offer a job on the spot there. But you guys, that's why you have a different perspective there. You were able to kind of see different things. And that was probably a good hire. I'm sure that person was very high energy. I'm sure that was not fake what she was explaining, but you kind of saw past that and saw some other issues. And it's important to do that. You've got to look at the whole picture. We're going to talk about that, the whole picture. That's a great point. But keep in mind, if you don't like something in the interview, it's not going to get any better after you hire. You mentioned 6 months down the road. Is that person better usually 6 months down the road? 6 months down the road, they're showing their really true colors. So what you want to do is look for those signs ahead of time and try to figure out what their true colors may be down the road. give the applicant an opportunity to ask questions from you at the end of the interview. And in the interview, by giving the applicant a timeframe of when you will be following up with them and stick to it. So everybody's got different ideas and about, you know, how they contact people and when they follow up with people and what kind of information they share back with people. My personal opinion is if you bring somebody in for an interview, you owe them a call back at least to tell them the status of the position, okay? I don't feel the need to contact everybody that applies for a position, especially if it's online. You know, you may get 100, 200 applications, and it's just not time efficient to, you know, follow up. Now, you may have a program. A lot of people have applicant tracking programs that will automatically generate letters. That's great if you can do that, but if you don't have time, don't worry about it. But if you actually make contact with a person, I think you owe them the courtesy of following through and just let them know where they stand. Any questions about that? Any questions about giving them an opportunity to ask their questions? Has anybody ever had anybody say, no, I don't have any questions? How does that make you feel? So there is some expectation to have a person kind of know a little bit about not only the job, the organization, the town. You know, ask something. You want to, you know, have some sort of interest that you can kind of gauge there about their questions.
How do we feel about people who ask me questions? How many days out can I get? Those types of questions.
Right, that's good. Great question. I think some of those questions are fine. But if you get a lot of them, that I think that starts to kind of tell a little bit of the story there. If it's all about me and this, when do I get this and that, that tells me a little something about that person. But, you know, if they've got a benefits question, you know, how do you guys handle raises, because they've got a year, I think a few of those questions is fine. They're just curious and want to know more about the position. You know, they may ask about the salary. You know, it may be a published pay rate that you guys advertise under, and everybody kind of knows that, but they may not know that. They may ask a question about what's the job pay. I think that's fine. That's a fair question. Anybody else on that?
Yes, no, not on that, but how do you feel about questions that probe the candidate about what they know about the environment they're going into? So what do you know about my organization?
So you're asking
what do they know?
Question?
Correct. Do they do any homework regarding what they're getting into?
Right.
Now, how do you feel about
I think that's a great question. Yeah. What do you know about us? What do you know about this job? You know, sometimes I'll hear people ask that on the front end of an interview, just to kind of get the ball rolling a little bit. But I think it's fine to ask that question. And it kind of just jumps to the end where you're already wanting to know what they know about the position.
I'm always worried about robots. You know, they send out 70,000 resumes to all these outlets, and yes, their resume looks fine. You bring them in, and you're just one of the ponds that they want to, you know,
right,
put their toe in.
Yeah, I think you're looking to avoid that. I have the expectation that a good applicant is going to know something about the job. I think that's a very reasonable expectation.
I like the question, what about the job description interest you enough?
Do you hear that?
Yes, thank you.
That's a great question.
What do you think about the Google questions? You know, if you had one superpower, what would it be? If you were a tree, what kind of tree would you be?
I think one of those is okay in the interview. They're kind of fun. My Google question is, if you could walk into a store and purchase a skill that you currently don't have, what would you buy? That's just one I kind of like. I like those. They're kind of fun. They kind of break the ice a little bit. They can give you some very good information and perspective about an applicant. I wouldn't have a whole list of questions.
So you'd ask it up front then?
I kind of put mine in the middle. there's no wrong or right there. But I do like one of those. But yeah, you can look those up. That's the one I like. I've had some interesting answers. This one.
We should do better if she is serious. But we just happened to have several interviews from one particular culture. And what we've noticed is that they are really good at asking questions. When you ask them, what did you think of this? How did you handle that? How do you feel about this? They freaks. How do you, I don't know, accommodate your sort of cultural, maybe just by happenstance, that entire culture. It's just, that's been our experience. Everyone comes from that culture. They don't handle these sort of touchy feely. How do you think, what do you feel about the kind of questions?
Interesting. I've never had that question. Do you have people in your organization from that culture that work for you?
Yes.
You may want to talk to them and ask them, is there something you're missing there? How do they handle those situations? Being in the moment. And maybe it's just the conflict arising from just being asked about it and being on the spot. So it may give you some perspective and information about how to change that up possibly. If you notice that, then there may be something to address there that you may need to change that question. Good question. All right, anything else? Let's see what's next here. I think we're getting close to the top. All right, so a great interview, again, just to review, is to make them feel comfortable. You're going to look at their experience, ask good behavior-based questions, and give them their turn to ask their questions of you. Now, this is just part of the puzzle. We're just talking about the interview here, right? So what other components need to be taken into consideration besides just the interview? We've already talked about the resume, the application, the experience. That's something that you probably reviewed before the interview. Now you've done the interview. Now what else? What else do we need to do?
Reference checks.
Reference checks. How many of you guys do reference checks? Awesome. That's so good. What I see in my experience is people do not do reference checks. The worst thing that can happen is you can call somebody and they don't tell you anything. That's the worst thing. But the best thing that can happen is you get somebody willing to share about this employee and tell you about their real experience. I cannot stress how important this is. Take 5 minutes and call their past boss and ask them about how this employee was. Save you tons of heartache and headache.
What, do you ever check into the school, see if they actually went to that school? But they might have never even went, they might have just ruled it off. They ain't going to figure if you weren't going to check. I mean, at least I can not think if you check the resume, the rest of you do the reference check and see if the person did the job. But if you never look at that, that's something you should look at, or it's not a big deal, or if they're doing the job, or what's the general consensus on that?
Did everybody get a question? Okay, yeah, so I think it's important. I think if you're really going to do a thorough job, you need to check. What's on the resume? I forget what the statistic is, but I mean, it's like half of people lie on the resume. And they put, it could be a little white lie, it could be a very big lie about degree.
Certifications are the biggest lie people tell.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah,
I'm Microsoft certified this and this kind of
thing. Yeah, yeah.
All of them.
So that's a big part of what you guys are looking for. I don't know if there's a way to check those certifications. There are ways to check industry certifications. I've done that. Somebody will put some letters behind their name. You can call up that organization and say, hey, I want to verify that so-and-so got SPHR certification. So you can verify that. As far as education, there's services that you can use. Or you can just call school sometimes and say, hey, I want to verify that John Adams graduated in 1993 with a BA in computer science.
You got to think most of the Cisco ones there, they give you numbers, so you should be able to verify them. The guy supposedly, I don't know what they say, he falsified his certifications, which I find hard to believe since the guy left, he went to working at Cisco. I mean, they're not checking their own numbers, but some job security like that.
I think it's a great idea. That takes more time to check all those things out, but I think it's worth the time.
in my particular profession, at my level, we have to provide our transcripts. My very first job at grad school, I had to come to my school. They hired me before I graduated, so when I came first day, it's not framed yet.
You know, I see different requirements in different industries. A lot of my clients, they don't know. It's all about that interview. You get snowball on there. Some of the things I put down, experience, skills, which I talked about. Assessments, does anybody work with assessments? Yeah. I'm a big believer in assessments. So these are different assessments measure different things, but some of the assessments that I worked with in the past are what they measure is preferred behavioral patterns. So, you know, I mentioned I'm a soft-spoken guy, I'm an introvert by nature. I mean, these are things that you can measure, and, you know, how they fit to the job that you're hiring for could possibly play a big factor in that. You know, if you're looking to hire a salesperson, you don't want to hire an introvert. You don't want to hire someone that is not afraid to go out and pound on doors and knock on doors and be confrontational sometimes. That's not me. I'm not a confrontational guy. I know I'm not a big salesperson, so different jobs have different behavioral preferences that match up for them. Background checks. You guys do background checks? I hope so. So a lot of my clients do not do background checks. I've got clients that send people into people's homes that do not do background checks. It's a little scary. So we definitely try to correct that. Background checks are very important. Again, it just kind of speaks to being hired and what their issues might be. And we talked about the reference calls. Again, please take 5 minutes, 10 minutes to call some of these people. You don't have to call every applicant. You know, just, you know, if you narrow it down to one or two, you know, make that be the tiebreaker possibly. Just call the best advisors so you get some feedback. Again, the worst thing that could happen is you call past employer of an applicant, and they say, you know, our company policy is we're only allowed to verify their dates of employment. Okay, that's a start. You know, now you're verifying what's on their resume, and if that's all they can verify, you know, keep asking questions. The worst they can say is, I can't answer.
We had applicants
request not to call. Yeah, okay, so that's fair. $47,476 a year, which is $913 a week. Doesn't matter what you do. You know, you guys, probably most of your employees work under the professional exemption of being IT folks. That's fine, but if they don't make at least $47,476, you've got a concept of overtime strike. No matter what they do, they can run a company, they can be everybody's boss. If they're not making this, they're not exempt from overtime. So, yes, ma'am.
We have a few people in that range. I was told that it's the range, where that those salaries are. We have a bunch of GIS analysts, and we have some computer support analysts that we actually just reclassified to a non-exempt position just to avoid this, because they were one left, and so we had an opportunity. But I was told it was the range, not the actual salary the person makes. Is that true?
That's not my understanding.
Okay, I didn't think so. That's what I read everything, and I'm like, but our HR department is telling me, well, if they're D4, which is what we call that range, and that range started at like 46 something, or wherever it started, because it's in the range, not because this particular person made 55. So I was confused about that.
Maybe this is something, but it's each individual person. If they're not making that amount, they can't be exempt.
Okay.
So you may have people in the same range, pay range, that are exempt.
Okay.
And that's okay. And I recently found out from a U.S. Department of Labor investigator that I was working with. She said sometimes even people in the same position, same job title, depending on their individual duties, they may be exempt and not exempt.
Right.
So sometimes that was an eye-opener for me. So, a more senior person may have more individual discretion about decisions that are being made versus someone who is hired. And so it's possible that that's two everything else has been the same with the rules, but just that minimum salary is going up from $24,000 to $47,000. It's a big change. I haven't heard anything. A lot of people on Capitol Hill are trying to fight this. I haven't heard anything about that happening. So, as far as I know, it's going to be effective on the 7th. All right. Anything else? Any questions? Any suggestions for the group? You guys had some great questions and samples and all those. I appreciate you guys sharing. Yes, ma'am.
I was wondering if anybody had a good source for technical questions for programmers. If you do anything that it's either, what's an object, or it's just 101, or it's like these, write this advanced algorithm, but there just doesn't seem to be anything that's just kind of appropriate in the middle to show their people what they know.
Anybody have any ideas?
Other than that,
we're all programmers on the panel, but we struggle with coming up with, questions that are sort of in the middle. You can ask, well, when does Java do, garbage collection or something? Well, it's really a stupid question. We never answer it. And then, on the other end, you do things, and it's like, if this person can't, program something that will keep pie to the, 3 billion. I like using the real life examples. I've seen that done.
various jobs. You know, it may not be technical, but it may, you know, if part of your job is writing, you know, grant proposals, you know, have that person. I would do it on the first interview, but maybe a second interview, you could have them write out the grant proposal. Or if they're a marketing person, you know, what are some of their marketing ideas? I love using the life examples. How it relates to the job. Anything else? Thanks for your time. Thank you for your attention.